Hi everyone. We're just going to get started right at the top of the hour. We have a great program for you today. Thank you and welcome to the webinar, Enabling Tomorrow's Batteries Through Comprehensive Materials Analysis. My name's Myra, and I'm the Director of Member Success at Volta Foundation. And just so thrilled to have everyone joining in today. Before we get started, I just wanted to share a couple of tips and tricks with the event platform just to make the program more effective for you. So if you're on the platform, look up into the top right corner. There's three different icons. The first is an icon with a question mark. The second is an icon that looks like a little report. And the third is a little gear icon. So to ask questions during the program today, you can select that little question mark icon and enter your questions in the space provided. Our presenter, James, he'll answer questions at the end of the program, as many as possible. And if he doesn't get to them today, then he'll follow up with you afterwards. The second, the icon with a little report, if you click that, there's additional handout provided by James, the Oxford Instruments team, some additional insight and thought leadership on today's topic. The third is the little gear icon. If you have any technical difficulties, audio issues, that's where you want to go for that. Otherwise, you can enter anything into the chat and I'll be in the background helping out. So now let's meet James. Dr. James Sagar is the business manager for the materials analysis group at Oxford Instruments. He also takes a lead on Oxford Instruments solutions development and strategic marketing for the battery industry. James has held several positions within Oxford Instruments over the last 8 years, with a focus on several different technologies, including electron microscopy and nuclear magnetic resonance. James had a particular focus on using these technologies to provide deeper understanding of battery materials, including product managing the world's first EDS detector capable of detecting lithium X-rays, and the world's first broadband benchtop NMR spectrometer capable of characterizing key battery nuclei in a single instrument. Before joining Oxford Instruments, James carried out postgraduate research at University College London and a PhD at the University of York, with a focus on developing materials with unusual electron transport properties. That's a great
Thanks,
background,
Myra.
James. Yeah. All right, I'm going to hand it over to you. Looking forward to the program today. Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you very much for that lovely introduction. I'm just going to turn my camera off so it's a little bit less distracting. And we can get on with the show. So thank you very much, everybody, for joining today's webinar. It's a real pleasure to be here to talk to everybody about something that I get really excited about, which is really understanding the nitty and gritty of materials using all sorts of different technologies. And specifically, how that can really enable tomorrow's batteries and I guess drive us towards a much greener future. And we all know that there is a big drive to developing new battery technologies. It's going to be key to saving a key part of saving the planet. But in order to do that, we need to make some really big developments in the technology. Now, depending on exactly whose metrics you pick, you'll see slightly different numbers, but here is some I picked, and I tend to like to position them around these sort of five key priority areas. So energy density, if you're looking to see what we should be achieving by 2035 to support the view of what we would need by then, you need to double that. You need to quadruple power density, so how fast your electric car can accelerate, I guess. We want to completely eliminate the thermal runaway, double the lifespan and half the cost. And that's some really big objectives. And depending on exactly what application you have for those, whether it's personal electronics, whether it is EVs, or even grid storage, there's big differences in where the priority lies in those areas. But in all cases, I think materials understanding and developing those materials is key to pushing out in all those different directions, even if for certain technologies and applications you might want to push in one direction more than others. And at Oxford Instruments, we have a number of technologies that allow us to deliver real critical solutions to lots of different areas in the whole battery supply chain, all the way from mining and extraction through processing those materials and looking at the R&D into cell manufacture, failure analysis, and eventually recycling to drive that circular economy. And you know, there is some really key measures that can be derived from those technologies, whether it's optimizing yield of extraction, whether it's understanding the purity of those precursor materials, or in fact doing some really detailed analysis of post-cycling electrode structure. That understanding really enables us to push the boundaries of what's possible. And we do that through four sort of key technology areas. NMR, nuclear magnetic resonance, which allows us to analyze the structure and chemical and physicochemical properties of both liquids and solids. I'll talk about two different types of NMR through the presentation today. Atomic force microscopy, allowing us to look directly at the surface and probe the surface of these materials, and not just visualize that and the topology of that 3D surface, but also understand the mechanical and electrical properties of those surfaces. Confocal Raman imaging and spectroscopy allows us to look at the surface and subsurface chemical structure of both organic and inorganic materials. And then we have a whole suite of technologies around the electron microscope, which we'll go into in a lot of detail today. So EDS, WDS, EBSD, and BEX. And one thing that we'll talk a lot about is correlating all those inputs to really build a comprehensive picture of what's going on inside your cells. So let's start by looking at the cell. You know, this is a typical schematic of what these batteries look like. And if we start at one end, we'll look at what sort of things we can start to measure with these technologies. So if we look at the anode, you can measure things like lithium content with both SEM, Raman, which is key for your energy density. Things like the quality of carbon material as well. So, exactly how much proportion of graphite or how you ordered your graphite is. Again, key measures for understanding what performance you can derive from your cell. As we move through the system, looking at electrolyte, we'll see a lot more NMR, where we typically have liquid and solution state analysis, things like concentration, purity, and ionic conductivity. I'll talk about the conductivity much in a lot more detail later. But also, we can start to think about how we might analyze solid electrolytes for next or subsequent generations of batteries. Again, in the middle there, we have our separators, where you're going to be looking at more carbonaceous materials or softer materials. So things like Raman, AFM, and NMR are particularly useful for measuring things like porosity and permeability. And then at the other end, we have our cathode, where you'll see a lot of the research and development interest going. So things like chemical consistency, particle size, powder purity, and things like that. But initially, today, we're going to focus on something I'm going to broadly call electrodes rather than specifically anodes and cathodes. Because a lot of the analysis here, although it will be specifically around either an anode or a cathode, is broadly applicable to both of those electrodes. So I'm going to start by talking about consistencies in electrode slurries and how we can use NMR to maintain and understand the mixing process and how that can affect the final product. So one of the big problems that is seen, and actually, as you'll see on the next slide, identified in the Volta report, is ensuring the quality and consistency of electrode slurries in the production process. Any changes there can have huge knock-on implications for the rest of the cell manufacture. We've developed a method using time domain NMR to allow slurries to be measured in a non-contact, non-destructive way to provide insights into the consistency of those slurries, either near the line or in fact potentially in line. And that NMR data gives us an understanding of the different relaxation properties of that slurry, which can be linked to particle dispersion, viscosity, and crucially, it potentially gives you an avenue to a real red light, green light test for the manufacturing of electrodes. And this is the page I picked out of the Volta report, this year's Volta report. And you can see right at the top of this process flow of electrode manufacturing that we have that mixing step all the way up here. Now, this is exactly what it says. Slurries are made by mixing active materials, binder and solvent, and how the combination of those changes can hugely affect coating and drying, but also exactly how the mixing progresses can have a bigger impact. And we want to be able to measure that so we can get a constant feedback of how our process is going. So I'm not going to assume any knowledge of the different techniques. So I'll give a little bit of an overview as we step through these throughout the webinar and how they impact our understanding of these materials. So in NMR, as we start at the over here, we put our sample in a reasonably large magnetic field. We irradiate that with radio frequency radiation. And that allows us to excite a state in that material. And then essentially, we detect and watch that excited state decay back to its initial position in line with the field. And that gives us this thing up here, our free induction decay. If we just take the magnitude of that, then or the intensity of that decay, that gives us a time domain signal, which we're going to talk about now. If we were to Fourier transform that, we would get the more typically understood NMR spectrum, which we'll talk about in a little more detail later. But let's talk about time domain and the free induction decay. Well, what happens there is that we're probing in the case of a electrode slurry and lithiated graphite, CMC, and water. We're going to predominantly probe the water with NMR. We're going to see that because that's got the majority of the hydrogen atoms that we're going to measure. And what we find in these samples is that we then have those water molecules in different environments, and that leads to different relaxation rates. So water molecules that are free will relax much slower than ones that are tightly bound to the surfaces of particles. And from that, we can infer something about what is going on within our slurry. So here we have two different samples, exactly the same composition. However, one is mixed for a lot longer at higher impeller speed. And it is immediately obvious that there is a big difference in the properties of these slurries. Now, the measurement that we're doing here, we're measuring a parameter known as T2. That is the relaxation due to expending energy back to the surrounding material. That gives us a measure of how tightly bound our measurand, in this case, more than likely water, is, and how tightly bound that is to surrounding material. So probably the graphite, carbon black, or the binder in our slurry. We can see those differences, and one way to show those differences even more clearly is to do an inverse Laplace transform, and we can see that we get two very different distributions. The distributions themselves look a little different, but as we increase that mixing time, we see a shift to much longer relaxation times, and also we see different components appearing. If we start to do a little bit more detailed analysis, we can do what's called a two-dimensional NMR experiment for time domain NMR. That is a measure of T1, so the self-relaxation, versus T2, the relaxation to the lattice or to the surrounding matrix. And that gives this distribution. We can again see very, very clear differences. If we look on the left-hand side, that standard process has a almost uniform distribution, as you can see in the T1, T2, whereas we get some clear differences in the distribution for that sample with the much longer mixing time. And this drives us to a hypothesis that for the standard sample, we have a reasonably well dispersed particles of pretty similar sort of size and distribution. Whereas for that overmix sample, we potentially have agglomeration of particles. And this means that we have much smaller surface area to bind to. So we actually have a lot more free water and binder, which is giving us those much longer relaxation times. One thing that's clear is that this is a good test of, is my process what I think it is? Because these are repeatable, as you can see from the dashed lines in the center there. But also, if we then take electron micrographs of those two samples, in this case in cross section prepared with a broad BMI mill, these are the same magnification, same size, same preparation. I think, although there's not necessarily the statistics on this single measurement, once it's processed onto a current collector, it would at first impression seem like we do actually have much larger particles for the overmixed slurry. And what's more is it's about 50% thicker once we coat it onto our current collector, which when you're manufacturing, if you start producing a 50% thicker layer of active material, then that's going to have significant implications going down the rest of the production process. So this gives us a really, really good non-destructive, non-contact measure of exactly what's going on in our slurry. Once we've made our slurry, once we've got it onto our sample, then, you know, there's all sorts of different analysis that we might consider that will affect the subsequent performance of our cells. So I'm going to take a little bit of a diversion now and look at sort of more common material, in this case in cathodes. So we're going to look at intergranular defects in some NCO and correlate a broad range of different data types. So we know that material consistency is key to delivering consistent performance from cells. And consistency can have all sorts of different measures, and whether you want it to be structurally consistent, whether you want it to be size consistent, you know, morphologically consistent, chemically consistent, all these things we can measure. And we measure most of those around the electron microscope and with a few standalone techniques. And by combining those, we can get a really comprehensive picture of exactly what's going on, not just that consistency, but also the level of detail that allows you to make big developments in your processes. But let's start with the chemistry of active material synthesis. So this is NCO. So you start with a hydrated nickel sulfate and a hydrated cobalt sulfate, and you mix those together with ammonia, depending on exactly your process. Everyone on this webinar will know that much better than I do. But you then lithiate it, and eventually you end up with your cathode active materials. But there's always a question of exactly, you know, do I have purity in my cathode active material? And if I don't, where are those impurities, and what's the effect going to be on my subsequent cell performance? So as I said, electron microscopy underpins a really large percentage of materials analysis generally, but also specifically in the battery industry. But there's a big problem in a lot of cases, is that if you just use your electron microscope and your electron column, you have a black and white image, right? You have grayscale image. But by adding additional analytical techniques, you turn this into something that I often like to call the Swiss Army knife of material science, right? You have all these different tools to help you through most situations. And we'll talk about a lot of these different analysis types over the next few slides. So let's look at our NCO cathode. You see the current collector in the middle there. We can see in our grayscale image that we have our nice particles. There's some small particles in there. And the things that stand out quite nicely are these big white spots. But we know that there's things there. We know that there's materials differences. We can see the morphology, but we start to lack a lot of the understanding of exactly what's going on there. Even though we can infer something from the types of contrast. This is a backscattered electron image. So we know that brighter material here is likely going to have a different, in this case, heavier composition than the lighter gray material. So when we do this, we move to a technique called BECCS, so backscattered electron and X-ray imaging. So we launched a new detector back in August, September last year, the first detector in the world on an electron microscope to do this, that allows you to simultaneously collect backscattered electrons and X-rays. This detector goes and sits under the pole piece, so we collect a large amount of X-rays, enabling us to do essentially real-time imaging with both the X-rays and the electrons, giving us the ability to discriminate not just the different types of material, but also actually put the types of element that we have alongside that. So essentially, we can color in our electron image with the types of element that are present in every pixel under the beam. So if we go back to our big picture, we can now see that we have some big changes in the chemistry. Now, most of it is a reasonable teal color, which is the NCO, which you'd expect. You'd expect it to be pretty consistent. So we can see the current collector in the middle there, that's a different material. We see that those bright spots have gone a lighter green. So we know that they are materially different to the surrounding material, but also some things that we weren't able to spot originally or not easily appear. So like this big purple spot up here, right? You know, what is that? And we wouldn't have necessarily spotted that on a first pass without collecting the X-ray information at the same time. But this is batteries, and batteries are all about chemistry, not just elements. So we need to understand not just what atoms we have present, but actually how those atoms are connected to one another. And for that, we tend to move to confocal Raman imaging and spectroscopy. This allows us to make direct measurements of the molecular bonds, the bonds between those atoms that we've characterized with our EDS, our X-ray spectroscopy. So we move our electron microscope sample under our Raman microscope, still inside the electron chamber. We illuminate that with a known wavelength of light in the confocal setup. That gives us a very high resolution. And that light gets frequency shifted depending upon the bond that it encounters and how it gets scattered. And that is very characteristic of the exact bond that is that scatters that photon. And from that, we can pass the scattered light back through the spectrometer, giving us our Raman spectrum. And we can separate out the different components within that spectrum to enable us to generate these beautifully colored spectral images. So now we don't just have what atoms we have there, we actually have how those atoms are bonded to one another. Raman in itself is an incredibly powerful technique, and it doesn't just stop at what bonds you've got. if you look at the intensity of a Raman peak, that allows you to measure the quantity of a material. Stress and strain in a material will shift those Raman peaks, so you can make a measure of strained versus unstrained material. The how broad a peak is will change, will allow you to measure the degree of crystallinity of that material, and also looking at the polarization of the material will allow you to measure the crystal orientation. We'll talk about crystal orientation in a couple of slides' time. But in the case of our NCO sample here, if we move this over to our Raman microscope, we can correlate and capture a Raman image from that same area. And you can start to see that we're seeing a few more components there. We're not just seeing the same things that we would see with the electron microscope. Our purple thing has gone blue just because of the color coding. We're seeing some different blue from where that bright green would be, but also we're starting to see much more signal from the carbonaceous material, the red here, and some other contrasts in there as well. And if we look at the specific spectra of those components, the red shows a carbon signal, which we would expect, and we have a number of different spectra that show similar metal oxide bonds. So we have this blue spectrum, this area here, which we'll dig into in a bit more detail. And we also have this light blue area here, which is, again, quite different. It turns out that that would be lithium titanate, which I'm not quite sure exactly how that got there in the sample, but is going to have a huge effect on the ongoing properties and the cell cycle lifetime if you have hard particles like that within your sample. And that's great. That enables us to now understand exactly the chemistry that is going on within our sample at the nanoscale. And we can see those variations as well. But I talked about crystal orientation, and that can be hugely important to battery materials as well. Now, in the electron microscope, typically if an electron microscopist hears, crystals orientation, they move to EBSD or electron backscatter diffraction. So in this case, what we do is we illuminate our sample, and that scatters electrons back to our EBSD detector. And by processing the resulting diffraction pattern that we get from that sample surface, we can characterize the different crystals that we have there and the different orientations of those crystals. We can also do more processing subsequently to pull out all sorts of information about exactly what's going on there. What does that mean in the context of battery materials? Now, this is a slightly different sample, but you can see we can map the orientation of the grains within our cathode particles to understand exactly what's going on there. Actually, we do this with a new software that we've just launched called Aztec Crystal Battery. This allows us to automatically identify particles, and by categorizing those particles and selecting them automatically, we can then give a set of orientations based on the particle's own coordinate system. In the case of this cathode particle here, that allows us to spot that our C-axis of our transition metal oxide cathode is orientated tangentially to the particle. Now, that's really important for the properties of this as a cathode, because it means that our lithium in our crystal structure, those lithium atomic planes are aligned perpendicular to the edge of the particle, allowing lithium to move in and out of those cathode grains much more easily than if the C-axis of this crystal was orientated perpendicular. And also, we can teach this. This is a machine learning based program. So we can teach it what is a cracked particle, what is a small particle, what is a an average sized particle. And we can start to allow it to select and analyze the particles appropriately and do that detailed characterization without a significant amount of user input. So if we go back to our NCO, we can now overlay our EBSD image on there that we've collected. And if we look in a little bit more detail, what we can see is that maybe there's a few of these z-axis or these orientations that are tangential to the particles, but actually in most cases it is pretty randomly ordered. So what we're really starting to do is build up a picture here that we've got a cathode material with a lot of inclusions, not a particularly well-ordered crystal structure, which means that it may not be a particularly good cathode. But one thing it is very useful for understanding exactly how important these techniques can be to deriving parameters and properties from these materials. Now, we talked a little bit about EDS and energy dispersive X-ray spectrometry. So essentially illuminating our sample, generating characteristic X-rays, and then these characteristic X-rays we can plot as on an energy spectrum. And from that, we can infer exactly and measure what is exactly under the beam. We can take that pixel by pixel, and we can build a two-dimensional map of the composition, of the elemental composition of our sample. And this is critical and is an incredibly widely used technique across everything in material science, but picking the right detector for what you want to achieve and what you want to understand can have a huge impact on the quality of the results that you're able to get. So if we go back to the physics of that for a moment, if you take a 10 kV electron beam, you'll generate electrons from a roughly 400 nanometers of sample. If you are able to move to lower KV, then you say 3 KV and still collect the X-rays and do the analysis, then you're now just probing 50 nanometers. If you can go even lower, you can get even higher spatial resolution in your X-rays generated. And when you're looking for nanoscale changes in your materials, then that becomes hugely important. If we move from 10 kV to 5 kV and collect the same area as this, you can see just the difference. Instead of having a blurry green image where you might be able to make out some particles, this is not overlaid with the electrons, this is just the X-ray image. You can now see that we have these clear defined particles, and we also can map the fluorine from the PVDF binder around those particles, allowing us to do that, you know, that next step in terms of spatial resolution of analysis. So let's apply that to our NCO. And you can see that we can now map at much higher resolution. We're able to see the compositional differences of not just those large areas that we were able to see before, but actually there are even smaller areas of that sulfate material trapped between the grains within these larger particles. We can also see that there is significant structure within this lithium titanate material that means that it's not just a single phase, there's multiple phases within there, and that potentially gives you some really good direction as to the origin of that hard particle, which enables you to make preventative changes in your process to stop inclusions like that getting in. And that's all well and good. That tells us exactly what we've got under the beam. It tells us the chemistry. It tells us how it's orientated. But what does that actually mean when you get it into a cell? Well, one of the ways that we can probe that is using atomic force microscopy. Now, atomic force microscopy is not necessarily that widely used in the battery industry. You go to the semiconductor industry, it's used all the time. Batteries, it's not necessarily found its niche in the same way. But the AFM allows us to visualize surfaces and the topography of surfaces down to the atomic scale. And we can use it in a wide range of materials, so polymeric materials, so imaging separators like the cell guard here, or in fact the unique morphology of cathode surfaces. And that's the typical use, is the sort of just the topography. But actually, we can start to use things, different modes of AFM and scanning probe microscopy, such as Kelvin probe force microscopy. Now, this is a slightly more advanced technique where we apply an AC and a DC bias voltage to the tip. And depending upon the work function and the relative work function of the sample of the point under the tip to the tip, you get a movement in the tip away or toward the sample. Essentially, you set off an oscillation in the tip. We then apply a DC voltage just to stop that oscillation, and that voltage allows us, we can plot that voltage pixel by pixel. And that gives us the surface potential or the work function of the surface. Now, that's a really interesting measure and is typically used a lot in corrosion and understanding thin film anti-corrosion layers. But that's potentially very interesting for battery materials because it allows us to understand how these chemical changes could affect how an electrolyte may interact with those areas of different chemistry within a cathode particle. So I've now gone back to my big picture and I've overlaid the Kelvin probe force microscopy image of that area, and you can see correlated with those large or those sulfate inclusions that we'd previously seen, bright spots in our KPFM. That means that they have a significantly higher work function. They're much more likely to corrode. And that's a pretty significant defect to have in a cathode particle. If that's corroding, it's going to lead to cracks, which is going to lead to degradation of those particles and essentially cell failure and a decrease in the lifetime. You can see one-to-one correlation between this bright spot here and that blue area there. And if we go back now, we can see how all of that overlays. Now, this didn't matter so much when it was in the interior of a sample of a particle, because it may be hard for the electrolyte to get into that area to start to degrade that particle. But what if you found one of these spots here that's right on the edge? That's going to give you a mechanism by which degradation can really start and can start quite quickly within your cathode. One thing you can do is once you've got all that data, you can bring it into a program we have called Aztec Relate. It allows you to bring all these different data sets together in a single place, overlay them and intertwine them and pull quantitative data out of those. So we can look at things like how the AFM topography, how the surface changes with crystal orientation, so EBSD. Or you can do the same with how do the topography changes with the elemental composition using EDS, or the chemical composition using Raman. You can see here actually it highlights a lot of the different chemical phases that weren't necessarily as obvious in some of those other maps. And we can, you know, overlay topography, Raman, and the KPFM to show that we really do get one quite a different morphology on the surface, but also very different work function of those sulfate areas. And that data is pixel/voxel matched, and that means that we can do actually quantitative analysis of mixed data sets. So we could look at, you know, having a plot of surface potential versus sulfur weight percent to really figure out exactly how small changes in composition are affecting the properties of that cathode material. Now, moving away from those hard materials and the cathodes and looking closer to the center of the battery and the electrolyte. So, as I say, sitting right here in the middle, looking at electrolytes, and it's a very different type of sample, right? This is a liquid sample, and people are wanting to find out very different things. It's also an often overlooked area of the battery that can have a significant effect on the power density, but also the cell cycle lifetime. If you get degradation of your electrolyte, it can really shorten the life of your cell. So if we look at the problem here, well, we know that we have our electrolytes, and if we want to maximize the power density, they must flow easily from one electrode to another. And enabling understanding how those ions move from one electrode to the other is critical. And understanding how that changes depending on the degradation or what type of electrolyte you're using is really powerful to enable you to develop better electrolytes and better cells. We use that using a broadband benchtop NMR spectrometer. And that system is equipped with several different technologies, including pulsed field gradients, which allows us to measure diffusion, or directly measure the diffusion coefficient of the cations and anions within a sample, from which we can then determine other properties. So as I said right at the start of this webinar, in the NMR method, we put a sample in a large magnetic field. We irradiate it with radio frequency radiation. That excites the state. We watch it decay. But in this case, we then Fourier transform that signal into our NMR spectrum. And we can tune the frequency of this excitation to the different nuclei. So proton, phosphorus, fluorine, carbon, boron, lithium, and sodium, all key elements in either current generation or future liquid electrolytes. And this is inherently quantitative. So we can take that and apply it to our typical battery electrolyte. You can see here that this will be a ethylene carbonate, dimethyl carbonate, diethyl carbonate, and vinylene carbonate. And we can measure the quantities of those different ratios to ensure that we've got the appropriate composition of electrolyte. And that's about a 1 minute measurement. So immediately enabling us to pick up really useful information about our electrolyte. The same way, if we move to 19F fluorine NMR, we take two spectra. This is an actual application example where someone brought to us two samples, clear liquids, and they said, what's the difference? One of these works really well in our cell and one of them doesn't. We took a single 30-second fluorine spectrum and we were immediately able to spot the difference. We see that doublet here that is different to our PF6 that we would expect to see from the chemical composition that we have, or the molecule that we have here. And that's a clear indication that this is starting a hydrolysis reaction. So instead of just being PF6, we're starting to see phosphofluoric acids that are that start to build up in the presence of water. So really, really useful. And that degradation can have a huge impact on other things. But we're talking here about conductivity. So if we use our NMR spectrometer and we play with the molecules that we have there and how we excite them, we can make different measurements. So using a special NMR pulse sequence, which we call pulse field gradient spin echo, we essentially spatially encode information into our sample. We then wait for a while, and we then, with the second set of pulses here, read out that spatially encoded information and then take our NMR spectrum. The result of that is, as we change the strength of this gradient pulse, we see a decrease in the signal. Essentially, less of the molecules were in the same place that they were when we initially spatially encoded the information, so the signal decreases. We can fit that to what we call the statistical Tanner equation, and the negative of the gradient gives us the, a direct measure of the diffusion coefficient of that molecule species. So the lithium cation, the PF6 anion, and if you apply the appropriate maths to that, so here we can measure the conductivity by Faraday constant, temperature, and the cation and anion diffusion. We can measure the conductivity, and we can also measure the cation transference. Again, direct measure of the transference number, incredibly important for understanding how these electrolytes affect the performance of a final cell. And you can see how this matters and how this changes from electrolyte to electrolyte. Remember, the gradient of these lines is a direct measure of the diffusion, which you can take as a measure of the conductivity. So LiPF6 in dimethyl carbonate diffuses much faster than TFSI in tetraglyme or PF6 in propylene carbonate, just as you would expect. But that ability to have a direct measure of how that diffusion property is affected by the chemistry, and also you can do this as your electrolyte degrades or subsequently once you've cycled a cell a few times, allows you to really understand the changes in that behavior and start to get a handle on the lifetime and potential safety aspects of your cell. And that's just a little bit of an overview of how this materials analysis and really detailed materials analysis can start to give you real answers and directions to develop these new battery materials. As Oxford Instruments, we're a global company. We have offices in all parts of the world and service to support an applicant, and importantly applications teams to support your battery and method development wherever you are. Now, as I said, I've just shown you a very small snapshot. We've looked at various different things that could come into QA/QC, but also, you know, there's other things that we can help with. Failure analysis, materials research, recycling, you know, much large areas using that Beck's technique, understanding elemental composition over very large areas of not just uniform or flat samples, but samples that have got big changes in topography, can be analyzed incredibly quickly with that unity detector, which is incredibly important for recycling and understanding black mass, but also correlating all that information. Again, you've seen just how important it is to get a handle on how structure, chemistry, and composition can affect the properties of these materials. So thank you very much for listening, and I'd love to take any questions.
Thank you, James. That was excellent. And thank you to everyone for listening in. We do have several questions coming in. So in about 10 minutes, we'll do some rapid fire Q&A. What do you think, James? Sound good?
Yeah, why not?
All right. Okay, I'm just gonna go through the list. Can you measure solid electrolytes using benchtop NMR?
Yes, is the answer. It's quite a complicated answer, but yes is the answer. You can not necessarily get the detail of the spectroscopic detail of those solids unless you've got a high field NMR, but on the benchtop you can start to get definitely diffusion data. We've got information, T1 data from garnet electrolytes and solid polymer electrolytes as well, which actually look really, really interesting.
All right. Perfect. Thank you. That's interesting. Several coming in. So I'm not sure if you can see them on your end as well. So next yep. one I see, can you measure diffusion at different temperatures? And I
Yes,
might
yes.
expand on that. And if so, if you can, what temperature range?
We can do that. And depending on whether you measure it with a time domain system or whether you measure it with a spectroscopy system, the diffusion range changes. The temperature range changes. Typically, somewhere from around 0 degrees to 60-ish degrees C for spectroscopy, broader range for time domain. But it allows at least allows you to plot out how that's going to how that conductivity is going to change over the typical operating temperatures of a cell.
Okay. So the key word there is typical operating temperatures.
Yeah, typical. All these things depend on exactly the conditions of the lab and things, but we always specify 0 to 60. But in our lab, we do tend to push either end of that scale to see just how far we can go.
Perfect. Thank you. All right, next one up. How can analyzing grams, sometimes micrograms of powder, be related to scaling up and producing kilotons of a material? Great question.
That is a really great question. And I guess the answer is statistics. If you're able to analyze something that is at least representative, then you can infer how that changes. If we look at the measurement at the start of this in terms of slurries, then yes, you measure a small amount, but you measure a small amount potentially quite regularly, and it allows you to understand, you track that with time, build a model as to how these things change. If you're looking at powders and the electron microscopy sort of type analysis, then techniques like Beck's that I showed allow you to do very, very large areas very quickly. So the image I showed, the big green one, that's actually not the whole image. And that took about 2 minutes. We've got to a point now where instead of just analyzing small areas, which is how I always used to do electron microscopy as a PhD student, we now just analyze an entire electron microscopy stub full of data, and suddenly the amount of statistics you're able to measure from that is huge. Spotting one in 10,000 particles that is a hard particle suddenly is you see a few of them on a stub and they pop out as a completely different color. And that's really, really powerful for the people who are looking at QA, QC of battery materials and looking to scale those up.
That's I'm sorry, I'm just thinking about the scaling question. That's great answer. Okay, let's see. A few more, several coming in. And just a note for the we have about 7 minutes left. I don't know if we're going to get through this large list. So just a note for everyone that James will have these questions. If we don't get it to them today, he'll follow up with you afterwards. Okay, let's dive into the next one. How can NMR be used in analyzing the cathode slurries?
Literally exactly the same way that I showed with the anodes. Actually, with cathodes, it can almost be slightly easier because you tend to have a little bit the ratio of binder in there where you get a lot of your protons for your analysis. There's slightly more, so you see exactly the same variation. Essentially, the same variations. You'll see changes in the relaxation time depending on mixing and composition, and we have some data that shows that it's just it was much easier and a much clearer difference to talk through in a webinar like this with those anode samples that I showed.
Right. Bit more complex of a of an answer visually. All right.
The answer is definitely yes.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. Perfect. Thank you. All right. Moving on to the next question. Is the Beck's detector compatible with all SEM columns?
Yes, as at least the majority that we've used it on so far. I mean, we have installations on Tescan, Zeiss, Thermo, Jale, Hitachi, and most of the columns. But by all means, come and talk to us and we'll figure out exactly how it's going to perform on your specific column. All the data that I showed here was collected on, I know, looking at the question, Zeiss Gemini is mentioned. All the data that I showed here was collected on a Zeiss Gemini column.
Perfect. Thank you. Yeah, that's great. I'm glad that you picked up on those examples. Thank you. Next question. Can you do spin echo measurements on slurry?
Yes. Yes, you can do with the time domain system. We have a version of that that does have pulse field gradients. So you can do the same types of measurements. You can measure diffusion. Actually, for those, I have some slightly different data as well, essentially a 1D profile, 1D NMR, MRI scan that shows whether you can get, or whether you get sedimentation of the slurry. And again, that's a reasonably quick measurement, but it allows you to tell exactly what's happening and whether your slurry is going to remain in suspension. You can also start to use the same thing, not just for slurries, but solid electrolytes potentially, and have a lithium-tuned time domain system that would allow you to measure the diffusion of lithium through solid electrolytes.
Perfect. Thank you. All right, we have about 3 minutes. You up for a few more?
Yeah, by all means,
all right,
keep going.
Let's do it. All right. Can you measure the thickness of the coated layer using these techniques?
Yes. Again, it depends how you want to do it. You can take cross sections and measure the thickness directly. Or we actually have a set of processing tools within our Aztec platform, analysis platform, that allows you to set up a model of what the structure you're expecting is, and therefore measure the thickness from the X-ray spectrum. You can also sort of do the same thing depending on the exact material composition with the confocal Raman. Because it's confocal, you get a very high resolution in Z, in the depth resolution. And if your material is at all transparent to that frequency of light, then you can change the focal position and you can collect Raman spectra from different depths within the sample. So you will be able to see changes in that composition, so measuring thickness and those sorts of things. So all that is possible. It just depends exactly how you want to do it. Being able to do it planar rather than cross-section makes things easier. Potentially being able to do it under a light-based optical technique rather than putting it in the electron microscope may make things easier again. But there are several different techniques, but it will depend exactly on the material and the, you know, the combination of materials that you want to measure.
That's a great follow-up question for that attendee if they have specific materials in mind. Definitely. All right. Let's try for one more question. We'll have about a minute left. Is that okay?
Yep. By all means,
so we're definitely not
going
to get to all of them. All right. So hoping that you can provide some insight on the correlative AFM and SEM. Am I doing that question correctly?
So yeah, I mean, the data that we showed there is definitely, was correlated, right? We took the same sample, took it from the electron microscope, put it in our AFM in the lab next door, and found the same area very easily, and we're able to measure. We can also input a series of coordinates into our AFMs. So our Jupiter large stage AFM, we can measure kind of large areas and scan large samples as well. And input a coordinate list so you can take measurements from several different areas. So if you can load in those coordinates of where your areas of interest when you load in your sample and the relative positions, then you can do that correlation quite easily. And it is an area that we're working on with quite a lot of effort at the moment.
Perfect. Another good follow-up question for that person who inquired. Check in with James if you have additional questions.
By all means, if you have any other questions, yeah. I'm more than happy to answer them.
Yeah. Well, there's several other questions in queue, but I will share these with you, James, after the program. And for anyone that didn't have their questions answered, James and his team will be able to follow up and address those. But I do want to be mindful of everyone's time. Thank you so much for joining, James. And just a huge thank you to the audience. Yes, absolutely. If you guys haven't joined other Volta Foundation programs before, check out the Volta Foundation events page on our website for future webinars, Battery Forum North America, Battery Pub, in-person virtual events, and Women in Batteries coming up this summer. All right, that's it for today. James, have a lovely evening. And
you too.
We'll
thank you
see
very
you
much.
Soon. Okay, bye everyone. Bye.